scale of temperature. Kelvin scale of temperature. So what is new about this? It's nothing new. The only difference is we are shifting the zero from origin to the minimum or absolute zero point. So basically this represents zero Kelvin. Now how many divisions we have? So if this would have been X degree centigrade, this temperature goes to X plus 273.15 degree centigrade. So if we extend this analogy, if this is the starting point for Kelvin scale, 0 centigrade temperature, so we could say that temperature on Kelvin scale is equal to temperature on centigrade scale plus 273.15. This is also clear from the starting point. This is the starting point of centigrade, this is the starting point of Kelvin scale, that means 0 and 0. The difference between them is 273.15. Hence, if we have to convert centigrade scale to Kelvin scale, so centigrade scale is 0, by that time Kelvin scale would have come to 273.15 Kelvin. So that's how a new temperature scale is defined, and it's very important to note that PV is equal to constant, that is our Boyle's law, or P by T constant and V by T constant. In all these gas laws, T, let's write here, P must be in Pascal, volume should be in meter cube, temperature should be in Kelvin. It's very important. Since we are dealing with pressure, volume, temperature and gas law, let's see what is standard temperature and pressure which is used in thermodynamics. So what stands for, let's say, is TP, that is stands for standard temperature and pressure. So standard temperature is equal to 0 degree centigrade, which is equal to 273 Kelvin, ignoring the decimal term, and pressure equals 1 bar, which is equal to 1.013 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal. So when something is mentioned as STP condition, we should assume that temperature is 273 Kelvin or 0 degree centigrade, pressure is equal to 1 bar, which is equivalent to 1.013 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal, and then we can use any gas law related to that. But the important point to note is pressure must be in Pascal, volume must be in meter, temperature must be in Kelvin when we are using gas laws to relate different quantities, otherwise we get the incorrect answer. Now let's look at a law which can combine all of these. So let's say P is inversely proportional to V, P is proportional to T, V is proportional to T. So can we say that P V is proportional to T? So basically from this we derive a law called ideal ideal gas law, which relates everything together. That means pressure into volume is equal to nRT. N stands for number of R0, number of moles in a system. So for example, this is the system we are talking about. So number of mole, and R0 is universal gas constant, and the value of R0 is 8.314 joule per mole per Kelvin. So if we knew this law in advance, probably it was very easy to derive any of the gas law we just now discussed, either Boyle's law, Charles law, or any other law. For example, let's try to derive Boyle's law from this ideal gas law. When temperature is constant, PV becomes constant, and that's what the Boyle's law says. If pressure goes constant, because mass of the system and the gas constant, universal gas constant, remains constant, V is directly proportional to T, or if V is constant, P is directly proportional to T, and that is what we have three different laws discussed individually. So basically, ideal gas law is a superposition of or combining all these gas laws together and getting a universal gas law which is applicable for all ideal gas. Now when we say ideal gas, what do we mean by it? Let's look at that. So basically we are saying that this is a system where lakhs and thousands of particles are entrapped and they are in random motion. So what we are saying is, when you say ideal gas, first of all, the size of the atom or molecules is very small. That means this particle is not occupying any space in this domain. It's so small. So that's the first assumption we have to make it an ideal gas. And the second assumption is, if we have a neighboring particle, there is no interaction force between them. Force of interaction is zero. So the second is interaction force is zero between two particles. If that is the case, then we say this is an ideal gas and it follows this ideal gas law. How we calculate number of moles? So let's say N is equal to, if we know mass or quantity of the substance, so let's say this is air and the mass entrapped is M. So mass entrapped is M, and if you divide by M, which is called molecular weight, we get the number of mole. So basically, if you know number of mole, temperature, gas constant is given, or if we know pressure, volume, number of mole and temperature, we could calculate even now universal gas constant. So for example, at STP, if we have 1 mole of ideal gas, it occupies only 22.4 liter. We can verify this, or we can use this statement to calculate R0, or we can verify this statement if we use the value of R0. Either way, it should be fine. So for example, let's say first calculate the value of R0. If we have to do that, STP means T should be equal to 0 degree centigrade. To use this law, we must use Kelvin scale, and hence in Kelvin scale it becomes 0 plus 273, that means 273 Kelvin. Pressure is equal to 1 bar, which is equal to 1.013 10 to the power 5 Pascal, and volume is given, V is equal to 22.4 liter. Again, you cannot use liter in this equation. We need to be in meter cube. That means unit should be, for this equation, let's say unit should be SI. Let's work in SI unit. So the SI unit is meter cube. So it becomes 22.4 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. So we know temperature, pressure, volume, and we are saying it's 1 mole, that means n is called 1. So using this, we could say R is equal to PV by T, and P becomes 1.013 10 to the power 5 into volume is 22.4 into 10 to the power minus 3 divided by temperature is 273. If you simplify this, you get 8.314 joule per mole per Kelvin. Now joule per mole per Kelvin is the unit for gas constant R0. Similarly, if we want to prove this statement, it's possible because we know pressure is STP, so we know this pressure, we know temperature, we know R0, and we know n is equal to 1, so we could get V. So basically V equals n is 1, so R0 T by P. Put the value R0 is equal to 8.314 into T 273 divided by P is equal to 1.013 into 10 to the power 5. We should get, the output should be in meter cube, so we'll get the value 22.4 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube, which is equivalent to 22.4 liter. This is how ideal gas integrates all the gas laws which we had discussed earlier and how it can be used for solving problems like this. So basically, to summarize it, we could say that gas laws relates pressure, volume, quantity of the substance and temperature. We could also have a equation ideal gas in relating mass in place of number of mole. We could see that since we know that n is equal to mass of the substance divided by molecular weight, we could rewrite the ideal gas law as PV, n becomes mass of the substance, m is the molecular weight, R0 T, let's keep m out, R0 by molecular weight into T, and now we could write PV is equal to m R T. Mind it, I am not writing R0, now it's R, where R stands for R0 by molecular weight. Now this R becomes gas constant. Why we call it gas constant? Why not it is universal gas constant? The reason is molecular weight will change. Let's say for oxygen, molecular weight is, oxygen molecular weight equals 32. For hydrogen it is equal to 2. So depending upon what molecular weight we have, the value of R will change, and hence it's specific to, so R depends on the molecule we are talking about. For oxygen, gas constant will be different. For hydrogen, gas constant will be different. So if we want to directly calculate mass of the substance, we should use gas constant and not the universal gas constant. But still it will be advisable to work with universal gas constant because it's independent of the substance we are talking. So let's first calculate the number of mole we have and then multiply with molecular weight to get the quantity of the substance, rather getting into this one. But it's possible to rewrite gas equation in terms of mass in place of in terms of number of mole. So it's possible that you may face a objective type question where a gas law is written in terms of mass and gas constant and not in terms of mole and universal gas constant. So be prepared for this, that this could be another form of ideal gas law. Let's now see a case of real gas. Till now we are discussing about ideal gas, so let's move on to real gas. So in case of real gas, as we had assumption for ideal gas, now same thing should be redefined for real gas. Molecules are not small, and the second thing, there is interaction or attraction force, attraction force between molecules. So basically molecules are attracting each other, and in that case how the gas law will look like. So basically we need to modify the ideal gas law to accommodate for the effects generated because of either size of the molecule and the attraction between the molecule. So it was developed by a gentleman called Van der Waals. So we call it Van der Waals equation. So basically Van der Waals equation is nothing new. It's modification of ideal gas law for real gas. So basically Van der Waals equation can be written as V, or start with pressure. So P plus, so we need to bring in additional term which accounts for effect of attraction, A square by V into, then you need to account for size of the molecule, so there has to be some reduction in volume, so V minus B, and which is equal to, as usual, nr0t. Now looking at this equation, we could say that when the volume or the molecule is very very small, B goes to zero, so you get only volume, and when there is no attraction, that means there is no additional pressure force coming, so it only P, and then you get the ideal gas equation P is equal to V. So for example, no attraction, therefore A square by V goes to zero, and molecules are small, therefore B goes to zero. So basically here A and B are gas constant, they are constant. So when A and B goes to zero, we come back to original ideal gas equation, which is PV is equal to nr0t. So basically Van der Waals equation is accounting for size of the molecule as well as the attraction force between molecules, and it is written like this. So where we have additional pressure term and reduction in volume because of the effect which is coming from the molecule, not small. So that's how we define a Van der Waals equation and assumption. Again, molecules are not small and there is an attraction force. So with this, basically we complete the gas law for ideal gas as well as real gas. Now let's go a little bit into thermodynamic process. because we are always talking about a state 1 to a state 2. So for example, we have a container filled with fluid at temperature T1, volume V1, pressure P1. And let's say we go from this state to a state temperature T2, V2 and P2. So basically there is something called thermodynamic process happening, and because of that we are moving from state 1 to a state 2. So basically thermodynamic process can be defined as an event where the thermodynamic property of the system is changing. If there is no change in temperature, volume and pressure, can we have change in or can we have a thermodynamic process? No, we cannot have thermodynamic process if there is no change in thermodynamic property. But if there is any change, whether temperature is changing, volume is changing, pressure is changing, if there is one property which is changing, then we call it thermodynamic process. It could be then, we could have a T is equal to constant process. So that means when we are going from 1 to 2, T1 remains constant. Or we could have a case which is V1 remains, volume remains constant. Or we could have case P1 is equal to P2. So this is when temperature remains constant, it is called isothermal process. Similarly, we could define, this is called isobaric process, isochoric process. Again, name is not important, the message is important. By changing the way we are going from 1 to 2, we could end up with new thermodynamic process. So that's how we defined thermodynamic process. Now we are going to discuss a thermodynamic process which is isothermal process. That means temperature should remain constant. Now we have one more process which we should discuss here, which is called adiabatic process. What it stands for? Adiabatic process, neither temperature nor volume nor pressure remains constant. So basically T, V and P, all three quantities are changing. So let's look at one by one. So right now let's discuss these two processes here. So first one, when temperature is constant. So let's redraw this system which represents, let's say, a cylinder block with piston. Now we have initial temperature T1, V1, pressure P1. Now imagine that this piston is moving downward. So that means volume is reducing. If T is constant, as per our Boyle's law or ideal gas law, pressure should increase. That is possible and will happen, but how temperature will remain constant? To maintain constant temperature, system must be losing heat to surrounding, and then temperature of this body remains in equilibrium. So this is T1 should be equal to outside temperature, and to retain this, the process should be very very slow, and the system must be exchanging heat with surrounding, then only the system remains in thermal equilibrium with surrounding and temperature remains constant. So that's the process we have. So in case of isothermal process, P1 V1 equal to P2 V2, which is nothing but a derivation from Boyle's law. The second one we are interested to discuss is adiabatic process. In case of adiabatic process, heat exchange from the surrounding goes to zero. Now if heat exchange with surrounding is not happening and piston is coming downward, all the three quantities, pressure, temperature, volume, should change, and then we have a relationship which is specific to adiabatic process, which is written as PV power gamma is constant, where gamma is a specific heat ratio. We'll discuss it in next session, what is a specific heat ratio. For the time being, let's remember as gamma is equal to Cp by Cv, and for air it comes close to 1.4, or let's say we'll derive it. So in addition to this law, which is PV power gamma is constant, since we are talking about an ideal gas system, it should also follow our gas law, which is PV is equal to nRT. So using equation 1 and 2, we can write adiabatic process law in terms of pressure and volume, pressure and temperature. So let's say when we have to write in terms of pressure and temperature, we need to replace V. So V equals nRT by P. So if you replace V with this term, you get P, nRT constant, so it goes on the other side, you get T power gamma by P power gamma, and therefore P power 1 minus gamma T power gamma should be equal to constant. This is another form of adiabatic process. Or in terms of, let's say, only volume and temperature, it should, P becomes from ideal gas law nRT by V, and hence let's put the value of P. We get T by V into V power gamma, therefore T V power gamma minus 1 is constant. So either way, this or this or this, all three equations are basically same, as we are using the ideal gas law equation to replace one quantity with other two quantities. So that's how the isothermal process and adiabatic processes are defined. Now if we have to just summarize that, what is the difference between isothermal process and adiabatic process, we could say that first, temperature remains constant in case of isothermal process, whereas in case of adiabatic process, temperature is changing. The second one is, in case of isothermal process, there is a heat exchange happening between the system and the surrounding, and system is in equilibrium with surrounding, whereas in case of adiabatic process, heat transfer across the system, that means from system to surrounding, is zero. So that's how we could summarize these two processes here.